Spirit would touch our hearts with the truth of the gospel and the message that we hear. Father, I pray that we would truly be the light of the world that you would have us to be, that we would not hide it, but Lord, in these dark days, that we would be more bold than ever before. Bless our speaker with an unction from the Spirit. And we pray that you're glorified in all things. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much, choir, for your ministry over the last 3 days. I appreciate it. Thank you for your faithfulness. Let's stand together. We're going to allow our choir to come down and join us as we turn around and greet those around us and welcome them to our services tonight.
As we're making our way back to our seats, let's sing that first verse of praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing all earth his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory, strength and honor give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song.
What a great crowd we have tonight. I am so encouraged and so excited, and I thank you for being here. And thank you, those who are visiting from out of town and from other churches here in town. I trust that you have already received a warm welcome. And right after our offertory, I'm so thankful that Pastor Paul Chappell will be preaching for us. I've told our church that we're only the 10th the size of Lancaster, and I'm humbled every time he's willing to come here and preach. Amen. And it's a great honor to have him. And as a pastor, we have 15 or 16 students in 5 different Christian colleges, but 10 of those are at West Coast. And the significance of that is that your pastor entrusts and recommends Bible colleges where I don't think our students will become corrupted. And so it speaks volumes about our church and its affiliation with West Coast Baptist College and other Christian colleges that we have young people. That means that the pastor has examined those colleges, and we're thankful for those other ministries like Heartland, Golden State, Pensacola. But I'm immensely thankful, as I have 3 children who went to West Coast, for the influence that's taken place in their life. And that comes from leadership. And I'm thankful for Pastor Paul Chappell, and I'm thankful for the message he brought last night. It was powerful, it was challenging, and I've chewed on that throughout today, reviewing my notes this morning and my devotions. And so, right after our offertory, I'm thankful that Pastor Chappell is back to preach for us tonight. Praying for our offering, I'm so thankful for Pastor Dan Dunham over at Victory Baptist Church in Vail, for ever since we first got here, over six years ago, he's been welcoming and been a friend to us, and I'm thankful for him. And so he's going to come and pray for our offering.
Father, thank you, Lord, tonight for the opportunity that we have right now. Lord, sometimes we may not see giving in an offering as an opportunity, but Father, you really don't need us. You have all the riches. You can supply all the needs, but you allow us to get involved in it. And Lord, thank you for that. It is a privilege to give. It's a privilege to give to your ministry and to your work. And so, Father, I pray, Lord, that we would all be blessed, God, by this opportunity that we have to contribute to this meeting and to help to cover some of the expenses of it. And so, Lord, just bless, Lord, this offering, make it meet the needs, and then bless this meeting tonight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope that wouldn't let go. If I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up. And if I told you my story, speak, then let it be of the grace. would hear victory over the enemy. If I told you my story, you would hear freedom that was won for me. And if I told you my story, you would hear life overcome the grave. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that brought me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. This is my story, and this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, and this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and when mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that took me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. That was beautiful, both vocally and instrumentally. And what a great joy to be here once again tonight. And I want to thank Pastor for the privilege of taking time to be here, and the privilege of just his fellowship. And the choir has been amazing and so improved from just 2 years ago, the size and the quality of the music and the way it's been honoring to the Lord, all the special music. Thank you for the meals. We had a wonderful morning today of instruction and fellowship with the pastors and Christian workers, and we appreciate it so much. All the hospitality, the men's trio was great this morning as well, and even Brother Lozano led the singing with great gusto today and did a great job with that. And so it's always good to see the graduates of West Coast Baptist College. I see several here tonight, even from other churches. Thank you for coming, and thank you for sending students to West Coast Baptist College. We are a ministry of a local New Testament, soul-winning, Bible-believing, missionary-minded, non-charismatic, independent, fundamental Baptist church. And we really believe that soul-winning is better felt than telt, and we believe that students need to see it in action from their professors, and they need to be involved in it while they're in college. And so while we're thankful for the quality academics, we're thankful also for the fact that students can get around a fire that's hot, a place where souls are being saved and baptized weekly, and just let that sink into their hearts a bit while they're training for the ministry. And I tell you that the students from this church are standout students. Their testimony is fantastic for you and for the Lord, and you can be very proud of their testimony there at West Coast Baptist College. Well, I want you to take your Bibles tonight and turn, if you would, to Luke's Gospel. And last night I was second in the order, and Dr. Ouellette did such a wonderful job in preaching with some brevity, and so the pressure is on, and he's a little bit better at it than I am, and he reminds me of that so often. And so I want to try to try to do well in that area tonight for him and for you as well. But let's stand together for the scripture reading tonight. Pastor, again, thank you for the wonderful fellowship. I had the privilege of preaching for Pastor Armstrong down in South Carolina and years ago, and I saw there his heart for preaching and soul winning and excellence in ministry. And it was my privilege when this ministry came in need of a pastor to have a small part in that process and to be able to come here and see what God has done. It really thrills my heart to see this. And those of you that are pastors in Arizona, New Mexico, you don't need me to tell you that we need strong Bible-believing churches that are going forward with not only old-fashioned Bible doctrine and separation, but also a good spirit of love and missions-mindedness and church planting. And so thank you for what you're doing here. And to the pastors that are here, thank you for coming and joining with us tonight. I did not recognize Brother Stoffel being with that beard. That just threw me off, brother. In fact, I kept looking up there going, who is that guy? And we'll have to talk about that afterwards. And don't tell me Jesus had a beard. I know that. I went to Bible college. I know that. But Oh, boy. Amen. All right. Luke chapter 9, verse number 46 is our text tonight. Luke 9, 46. I'd like to speak in these next brief moments on the subject, who is the greatest? Who's the greatest? Luke 9, 46. Then there arose a reasoning among them, which of them should be the greatest. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a child and set him by him, and said unto them, whosoever shall receive this child in my name receiveth me, and whosoever shall receive me receiveth him that sent me. For he that is least among you all, the same shall be great. And John answered and said, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and we forbade him, because he followeth not with us. And Jesus said unto him, forbid him not, for he that is not against us is for us. Let's pray together. Father, we are here tonight as a people from different cultures and backgrounds and institutions of Christian learning, different churches, and we're here by divine appointment. We're here tonight to learn how to serve you in the way that you would have us to serve. And so I pray that you would empower me with your spirit and that you would empower every listener, that we would not miss the voice of the Holy Spirit of God speaking through your word tonight. And I thank you again for the privilege to be here with this dear pastor, his family, and this church family. And so bless them, Lord, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Luke chapter 9 brings us to the conclusion of Jesus Christ's Galilean ministry, the great Galilean ministry as it is called. And today Jesus is back in Capernaum with his disciples. And this period begins a time where he would begin his journey now to Jerusalem. He would go down obviously through Jericho and ultimately up back into Jerusalem where he would die on the cross for our sin. And all along the way he is training his disciples. He is spending much time with his disciples. And it's interesting that this text we read a moment ago follows immediately after Jesus had spoken to them. And I want you to notice what he says to them in verse 44. Let these sayings sink down into your ears, for the Son of Man shall be delivered into the hands of men. And I want you to notice the phrase there. Let this saying sink down into your ears. Jesus is saying, get this. Don't miss this. Every once in a while, when my youngest son Matthew wanted my attention, and I was often too preoccupied with all things ministry, and I thought everything that I was doing was so very important, and Matt would crawl up onto my lap, and he'd be talking to me, and I'd be on the phone or doing something else, and he would just grab me by the cheeks and turn my face to his face and say, Dad, I've got something to tell you. He wanted my attention, and Jesus wanted their attention. He said, I want you to let this sink down into your ears. Don't miss this. And it's in this passage before us that we find great insight into some of the leadership weaknesses that often hinder the momentum of our local churches and often hinder the momentum of our independent Baptist fellowship as we move forward in this 21st century. We'll see some of the weaknesses that we must overcome by the grace of God if we will see greater works than these accomplished. And I want you to notice in the text, first of all, tonight, that there was a defective reasoning amongst these disciples. These disciples had a defective way of thinking. And while Jesus is here in verse 44 telling them, I want you to let this sink down into your ears, for the Son of Man shall be delivered into the hands of men. Just let this sink down into your ears. He's saying, I'm going to be delivered into the hands of men. He knew already what Judas Iscariot would do. He knew already what Pontius Pilate would say. He knew already what would happen at Caiaphas' house. He knew already that he would be taken to Golgotha and that he would lay himself down there for our sin. And so he says, let this settle into your minds. I'm going to be delivered into the hands of men. I'm going to die. I'm going to die, and I will rise up again in 3 days. And so as he tells this to them, the very next recorded words of the disciples we find in verse 46, they are reasoning amongst themselves who would be the greatest. Now just think about that for a moment. It would be like someone coming up to me tonight and saying, Pastor Chapel, pray for me. I am terminally ill. The doctors have given me just a little time to live. Pray for me in this time of my life. It would be like me looking at that person and saying, oh, by the way, Friday I'm going to go to Magic Mountain with some of my friends. You want to go? When Jesus has just announced his death and they're reasoning amongst themselves who should be the greatest, I have to ask myself, how dumb can you get? And yet when we see some of the trivialness of various people in church today and sometimes amongst various ministries today, in light of the soon return of Christ, we must ask the question, how dumb can we be to piddle in such little things when there is a great moment coming when the trump of God will sound and the dead in Christ will rise and we will also join them in the air? Amen. How dumb can we get? Jesus says, think about this. And so notice, if you would, in their defective reasoning, there was a contentious rivalry. Then, notice verse 46, then there arose. Here we see natural leadership as opposed to spiritual leadership. Here we see an ungrateful spirit in their midst. And this contentious rivalry was an ongoing issue with the disciples, and I believe it was because of the pride in their hearts. For the Bible says in Proverbs 13 and verse 10, only by pride cometh contention, but with the well-advised is wisdom. And out of the pride in their hearts, there was a contentiousness about who was going to be the greatest with the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Matthew 19, 27, then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we have forsaken all and have followed thee. What shall we have therefore? This was the attitude the disciples had. You know, Lord, we left everything. I mean, we left good fishing boats and good fishing nets and a good occupation, and we have followed you just like you said. What are we going to get out of it? And sometimes if we're not careful, we can have this attitude. Well, I've been in the church this long, or I've been in the pastorate this long, or I've made this many sacrifices. Lord, what am I going to get out of it? And in a spirit of pride, we begin to have a spirit of expectancy that is born that oftentimes will lead to disillusionment. How strange that these 12 should respond as they did to another announcement about the cross by the Lord Jesus Christ. They continue arguing about who is the greatest. And we see this as a pattern. The Bible tells us in Mark chapter 9 and verse 33, and he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, what was it that ye disputed amongst yourselves among the way? But they held their peace, for by the way they had disputed amongst themselves who should be the greatest. You see, they were constantly worried about how they were perceived and what position they would have and what they would get. And they were forgetting Psalm 75 and verse 6, for promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south, but God is judge. He putteth down one, and he raiseth up another. And my friends, tonight, it's not for us to worry about prominence. It's not for us to worry about prestige. It's not for us to worry about the promise of tomorrow. It's for us to be faithful to Jesus today. And yet with this pride in their hearts, they wondered who's the greatest. With this ingratitude in their hearts, they wondered who's the greatest. It's interesting to find in chapter 10, Jesus tells us the disciples were able to see some great miracles happen, and yet they were not grateful for the fact that they were able to be with the Lord. They were grateful many times for the wrong things. Notice, if you would, in Luke 10 and verse 17, it says, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. They were excited to see that the name of Jesus had such power. But look at Luke 10:20. It says, "Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice that your names are written in heaven." So they were all excited about their big moment. They were all excited about their big day, their big attendance, their big opportunity to cast out devils. And I really believe that there have been times in my life when I have rejoiced for all the wrong reasons. Jesus does not want us merely to rejoice over what he does for us. He wants us to rejoice over the fact that he is with us. He wants us to rejoice over the fact that he is our Savior and that we can have relationship with him. And oh, listen tonight, let's not merely rejoice when God does something for us. Let's rejoice every day that he has saved our soul and placed our feet upon a rock and established our goings and that we're heaven bound tonight. And it doesn't matter if you have 50 or 500 or 5,000 in church, or if you make $15 or $50 an hour, what you ought to be rejoicing in is the fact that you are a child of the King tonight. Jesus said, don't just rejoice over the miracle, rejoice that your name is written in heaven. But you see, they weren't grateful anymore for that. They deserved more. Why, they had really sacrificed for Jesus. Colonel James Irving is a former astronaut who was a part of a crew that made a successful moonwalk, and they experienced things that no men really had ever experienced prior. And they were on their way back to Earth, and he began to watch the Earth as they were coming back down, and Colonel Irving began to think about how life might be different once he came back to Earth. And he began to think about people that would ask questions, and some would perhaps view him as an international celebrity. And he said as he was coming back down to Earth, and he wrote these words, "As I was returning to Earth, I realized I was a servant, not a celebrity. So I'm here as God's servant on planet Earth to share what I've experienced, that others might know the glory of God." May we always be mindful of the fact that we are servants, not celebrities, and that it is our privilege to point men and women and boys and girls to Jesus Christ. There was this contentious rivalry. Then there arose. I've seen it happen in churches and on mission fields amongst missionaries, and I've seen it happen amongst preachers with little things here and there. There arose these certain things. But notice, secondly, it was then a contemplated thought. For the Bible says to us in this verse, number 46, "Then there arose a reasoning among them which of them should be the greatest." Notice the word reasoning. It means a deliberation. It was something that was a contemplation within their thought. It was an inward thought process in their mind and thinking about how important they were. Reminds me of the story of a young attorney that passed the bar exam. He became an attorney. He got his office. He was so impressed with that, and he was so impressed with his desk and his furniture and his phone and all things pertaining to his newfound job. And he sat there at his desk. He had his feet up on the desk, and he heard someone walking down the hallway coming towards his office, and he knew they were coming into his office. And so he thought he would just kind of be impressive. He picked up the phone. He said, "Hello, what can I do for you?" "Well, that'll be $200 an hour." And he's carrying on this whole conversation, and a man standing at the desk, he said, "Yes, can I help you, sir?" And the man said, "Yes, I'm with the phone company. I'm here to hook up your phone for you." Sometimes if we're not careful, we can get a little overly impressed with who we think we are. Luke 6:45, "A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh." And these men, from the abundance of their heart, were speaking what they had been reasoning within their heart. And their reasoning, notice this in verse 46, "Then there arose a reasoning among them which of them should be the greatest." And if you're looking into the word greatest, you'll find that this is an irregular comparative of the word megas. It means that they were asking themselves, "Hey, which of us is the mega? Which of us has the mega influence? Which of us has the mega ministry?" They were thinking about their rank in the kingdom. And we must recognize as we look into this passage that God's ways are not our ways. And in this world of upward mobility, God is calling us to descend into greatness. God is teaching us that if we'll humble ourselves, then he will lift us up. God is teaching us that the way to receive is by giving. God is teaching us that his ways ways are not our ways. And somehow they were morphing the world's contemplation and concepts from the Harvard Business School Review. They were somehow trying to put a little bit of business management into the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. And they were saying, hey, how can we climb the ladder? How can we be the big ones around here? How can we have the mega ministry? They were reasoning this way. Which of us has the mega ministry? Yet the scriptures are clear when it comes to this problem. Romans 12:3, for I say through the grace given unto me and to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Philippians 2:3, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than himself. James 3:14, but if ye have bitter and envy strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, and devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. And I want you to mark it down that when we become more concerned about who's the mega and how come they got attention, and well, I'll tell you what's wrong with that guy, and with we, when we start playing these little games that the world and the business world likes to play, we are in a bad position, because God has said to us clearly, this reasoning is not heavenly, it's earthly, and it does not please God. Most of us, frankly, are not really prepared for what we think we're capable of. Oftentimes, we think we can handle things so easily. It's interesting to me, later on in the Gospels, we find that when Jesus was at Jericho, the mother of James and John also thought this of her sons. And listen to what she says in Matthew 20:20. Then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, what wilt thou? And she said unto him, Grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on the right hand and the other on the left in thy kingdom. By the way, where did the boys start getting those thoughts anyways? Mama wanted to make sure they had a good self-esteem, didn't she? And they heard their mother saying, Lord, grant that my sons may be on thy left and on thy right. But Jesus answered and said, ye know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said unto him, we are able. And oftentimes we get that idea. You know, this ministry is a little below me. I could do more than this. I deserve better than this. And Jesus said, ma'am, do you know what you're asking? You want your son to be next to me on the right hand and to the left. Do you know what's about to happen to me? Do you know the baptism that I'm about to be baptized with? I mean, do you really want that for your sons? Do you really think they can handle that? And they said, oh, we can handle it. We can handle anything, Lord. I think tonight would be a good time to remember that without him, we can do nothing. But you see, when you have that mega mentality, when you have that who's the greatest mentality, then all of a sudden you think that everything else is below you and you can handle something much farther. I heard about a man that was honored with an honorary doctorate at a major university. He was introduced to the audience by the president of the university, and as he was introduced, they said, tonight we have a very great man in our midst. And they paused and said, no, tonight we have a very, very, very great man in our midst. And during the ride home, the man was contemplating the evening and the degree and the comments, and he put his arm around his wife and he said to his wife, sweetheart, how many very, 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 very great men do you think there are in this world? And she said, one less than you think. This defective reasoning that brought divisiveness and that displeased our Savior is something that creeps into all of our hearts over periods of time. But notice secondly, the declarative reproof of Jesus. The declarative reproof, verse 47. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, by the way, he always does. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a child and set him by him and said unto them, whosoever shall receive this child in my name receiveth me. And whosoever shall receive me receiveth him that sent me. For he that is least among you all, the same shall be great. Now notice the perception of Jesus. Jesus often perceived the thoughts, The scripture records for us in Luke 5:22, when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, why reason ye this in your heart? Psalm 139 in verse 2, thou knowest my downsitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thoughts afar off. He knows what you're thinking about right now. He knows every thought that we have. And here he says, listen, I know what you men are thinking about yourself. And so because of that, he gives them a picture of truth. He gives them an illustration that they would not forget. And Jesus often used little children as object lessons when he was trying to teach different truths to his disciples. And so he brings a child, and the Bible tells us in Mark chapter 9 and verse 36, he actually placed this child on his lap. And by bringing the child next to himself, Jesus was giving an honored position to the child. He was placing the child where these men, these mega men, wanted to be. And in doing so, he was honoring the child. And throughout Roman culture, children were not honored. And oftentimes, they were orphaned and neglected, and they were treated as slaves and servants, and they were treated as property. But Jesus is saying, listen, I'll tell you what being important really is all about. I want to tell you what service is all about. And he brings the child up next to him. May I just pause to say tonight, never think that because you work with children, you're doing the least important. Thank God for our youth pastors and Sunday school teachers and bus workers who labor with children. Charles Francis Adams was a 19th century political figure and diplomat. He kept a diary, and one day he went out and he came home and entered into his diary these words: went fishing today with my son, a day wasted. His son, by the name of Brooke Adams, also kept a diary. And he wrote in his diary on that same day, went fishing with my father, the most wonderful day of my life. Never underestimate your investment in the life of a child. Jesus, in bringing this child to his lap, shows us a picture of humility. The Bible says in Mark 10:14, but when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. The first lesson Jesus used is to illustrate how important even the child was to him. This was a picture of humility, and it was a picture of service, for the Bible tells us that as Jesus now brings this child to himself, he is involved in caring for even someone that was insignificant in the world's eyes, even someone that could offer him nothing. You see, when you're climbing the ladder and when you're worried about your mega position, you're going to kind of look across the crowd for the important one, for the mover and the shaker, for the one that can help you with your cause, and you're going to be very politically minded. And Jesus is helping us to recognize that a measure of a man's greatness is not how many people serve him, but how many people he serves. And that's why Peter said, humble yourself therefore under the mighty hand of God, and he may exalt you in due time. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to be a minister, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Hudson Taylor, the great missionary to China, was in the missionary housing compound one day when a great amount of rain began to pour in upon their residences. And in fact, so much rain came that a lot of trash and debris was caught into the gutter system of the missionary compound. And there were two missionaries there that saw the flooding taking place, and they were standing looking at the flooding, and they were arguing over who should solve this problem. One man said, I am Cambridge trained, and I had this GPA, and I don't do this type of work. And the other man said, I'm Oxford trained. And they were literally arguing about who should take care of the problem. And as they stood there and argued, Hudson Taylor climbed down into the sewer and took the garbage out. Who's the greatest? Who's the greatest? Jesus tells us the greatest is the one that is the servant of all. May we never forget that we're not above soul winning. We're not above cleaning. We're not above visiting. We're not above forgiving. May we never forget that we are called to be the servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. And how I thank God for the privilege of serving. And the Bible says in Luke 14:11, for whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. And so we see a defective reasoning. Who's the greatest? And then we see, secondly, a declarative reproof. If you want to know who the greatest is, look to see who's serving. But then I want you to notice, finally tonight, a discerning reminder. I want you to see a very discerning reminder that's given to us from our Lord. In verse 49, we see John's misunderstanding of this entire moment. He's missing this teaching moment. Verse 49, then John answered and said, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and we forbade him, because he followeth not with us. Now, in these times, our Lord had given to his disciples power and authority over the demon world. We see that in Luke 10, 17, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. But here in verses 46 through 48, we find that in this moment of rivalry between the disciples, there's not only a rivalry in their midst, but now there's going to be a rivalry with another group of disciples. And that seems to be the way it is with contentious people. It seems to have a bleed-over effect sometimes. And these who were having rivalry amidst themselves, John now says, as he looks across the way, he says, Master, we saw another man casting out devils in thy name, but we forbade him. Now, please mark in your mind tonight that the problem was not a problem of orthodoxy, for this man was casting out devils in the name of Jesus Christ. The problem, simply stated, was that the man was not a part of their fellowship. He was not a part of their group. And so John, in the way that is only accomplished by those who are concerned about being the greatest, John looks at this man who, yes, tended to be on maybe the fringe of things, nevertheless, was doing this in the name of Jesus, and he said, Lord, I just want you to know, we forbade him from doing that because, you know, we're in charge as the mega guys of discerning who's right and who's wrong and telling others what they can and cannot do. So, Lord, we want you to know we did you a favor, and we have branded him ecclesiastically, and we have let him know that he is not in the right path. John had a misunderstanding in his spirit. Notice, if you would, Jesus' mentoring of John. Look at verse 50. And Jesus said unto him, Forbid him not, for he that is not against us is for us. Jesus' reply is succinct. The disciples should have never made such a prohibition. The 12 wanted to exclude him, but Jesus wanted to include him. Now, please understand my heart tonight. I'm not speaking about some type of ecumenicalism. I'm not speaking tonight about some kind of compromise and just trying to include those with false doctrine. But I am simply saying tonight that oftentimes there are moments with people that are orthodox, fundamental, Bible-believing, King James preaching, people that are doing the work of God. And if we're not careful in our mega spirit, we will marginalize someone that Jesus wants us to have fellowship with. His reply was very clear. The disciples' ministry was not an exclusive ministry. May I say something to you tonight? Our ministry is not a ministry that is to be given to some type of exclusion of other Bible-believing fundamental Baptists. May I remind you tonight that Reaching America will be a collaborative effort. It will be an effort where a few people at least get right with God, where pastors begin to pray earnestly and fervently, where churches begin to work with their pastor. And we must recognize the need for praying for one another and encouraging one another. And I just would ask you a question tonight. When's the last time you wrote your pastor an encouraging note and said, keep preaching it, pastor? When's the last time you wrote a fellow pastor a note and said, hey, glad you're over there in that part of our city or that part of our state? And I'm simply saying, instead of trying to exclude someone and being so proud of it, when was the last time you went to someone that maybe was someone that could be rescued or encouraged or helped, and instead of marginalizing them, we say, hey, we're thankful for what God is doing in your ministry. 1 Corinthians 1 and 10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, that by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I'm of Paul, and I'm of Apollos, and I'm of Cephas, and I'm of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Christ crucified for you? Or were you baptized? Or was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? In other words, he said, listen, stop this nonsense of saying, I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of this group, I'm of that group, and get to the place where you can be happy when someone's seeing souls saved and seeing lives changed, and where you can say, hey, it doesn't matter who gets the credit or the glory. Thank God there's a revival over there. Thank God that missionary came. Thank God for that church planter. Thank God for that new member. Thank God that the work of God is going forward. Amen. This who's the greatest mentality will kill any prospect for revival. And so I encourage you tonight, don't allow that defective reasoning into your heart. Be willing to serve people who can offer you nothing. And be careful of jealousy creeping into your spirit. Charles Spurgeon and Joseph Parker were contemporaries in London in the late 1800s. Spurgeon, as many of you know, had orphanages that reached across England, and as did George Mueller during that time, these men were trying to minister to the homeless and doing their best to reach the orphans. And one day, Joseph Parker stood up in his pulpit and he commented something to the effect that Spurgeon's orphanages were not up to a particular standard, and probably did like us preachers can do, said something that wasn't really clearly thought out before he said it. And somehow, in the making of that comment, it was reported to Spurgeon that Parker had criticized his work. And boy, Spurgeon got up that next Sunday and he blasted Parker from his pulpit. Well, the next Sunday, people flocked over to Parker's pulpit. They didn't have Facebook and the internet back then, you know. They had to wait 7 days. The people went over to Parker's and they wanted to know, all right, what's he going to say about Spurgeon? Boy, the fight is on. And Parker stood up in the pulpit that day and he said, I understand that Pastor Spurgeon is not in his pulpit today. And this is the Sunday that an offering is normally taken for the orphanage. And he said, I would like our church to take an offering today for Spurgeon's orphanage. The Spirit began to move. They took another offering, and the Spirit continued to move, and they took three offerings for Spurgeon's orphanage. The next morning, Parker and some of his men went to Spurgeon's office. They brought in bags of money and put it on the desk, and they said, Brother Spurgeon, this is for the orphanages. And Spurgeon looked at Parker, and he simply said these words, Parker, you have practiced grace on me. You have practiced grace on me. May I encourage someone tonight, instead of being a scorekeeper, to be a grace giver? May we all be encouraged tonight to recognize, in light of the fact that Jesus said, this temple will be taken down, that Jesus said, I will be crucified, and they said, who's the greatest? May I consider, have you consider with me tonight that Jesus Christ is coming soon, and this is no time to worry about who's the greatest or who gets the credit. This is just a time to serve and to witness and to be faithful for the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for this passage, and Lord Jesus, forgive us for those times when we think we are more worthy or more deserving or more helpful to you. Help us to realize, Lord, that without you, we can do nothing. And Father, help us, even as preachers, to labor with love and encouragement and gratitude for other men who have good, sound doctrine and who win souls. And may we rejoice in every victory of these last days, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
What a great start. Amen. I think we all need to come forward and get right with the Lord right now. But we're going to march on. I do think it would be appropriate, though, if the Lord spoke to you, for in the quietness of the moment, do some business with the Lord. So I'm going to ask Christy just to play softly. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. Who's the greatest? Let's do some business with the Lord for just a moment. Father, thank you for the preaching of the Word of God. We love you tonight, and help us not to be lifted up with any type of spirit of pride. But Father, may we look forward to that day when we're able to be with you and look over the vast number of souls that's been saved just because we were faithful, not worrying about who was getting credit. Father, may we win souls, may we tell people about your Son, Jesus Christ, and may we see a revival in our country. In Jesus' name, amen. Our men's trio is going to come and encourage us with a song, and right after they sing, we're going to wrap up our conference tonight with Dr. R.B. Ouellette, and he's going to come and preach for us. I'm so thankful for his ministry, his many years of faithful preaching in Saginaw, Michigan, in spite of a decline in population, still winning souls and still going forward. And I'm so thankful for his words of encouragement to your pastor over these last couple of days and then the excellent sessions he brought today here at our church. So right after our men's trio, Dr. Ouellette will come and speak.
I dreamed my life was done, and I stood before God's Son. It was time to see what my reward would be. With love he reviewed my life to count what was done for Christ. For that was what would last eternally. See, I'd done my best to share that Jesus really cares, and he would save if they would just believe. Oh, but seldom did harvest come. So few did I see one, until the Lord said, turn around and see. Then he showed me the face of the ones who'd come because of me. So many faces that my life had led to Calvary. All those years I thought nobody saw, as I labored in lowly when Jesus smiled and showed me all the faces. He said, though you did not see the yield, you were faithful to plow the seed. No matter how small the task, you did just as I asked. And thanks to you, these souls have been set free.
Well, thank you so much, Brother Armstrong, for letting me come. What a great meeting. Thank you, Tucson Baptist, for the wonderful work that you did. Everything was just sharp, first rate, great music, great meal, a great crowd of preachers, a good number of folks from the church. How many of you have been here every single night of this Striving Together meeting? That's good. How many have been here every night but one? That's the rest of you. And very good. We're glad you're here as well. I appreciate that. I like coming to this church for a lot of reasons. I like the warm and balmy weather of Tucson that I get to enjoy when I come down here from Michigan. I like this part of the country. I like to see the mountains and look at the cactus and a few things that I don't see too much in Michigan. I like being at this church and seeing people that have been saved and are coming since the last time I was here and all the improvements in the buildings. And I get kissed more at this church than any place I go. I do. I've been kissed 4 times so far, all by the same person. And I like it. I like it. Oh, Vicki, I like it. That's great. Now, Brother Chaplin, I have a friend in the San Diego area, and Brother Clint Miller, he kisses me when I preach there. He was in Hollywood before, and he'll hug you and he'll kiss your cheek. I don't think he's funny, but I noticed when I kiss him back, he giggles. But I love Vicki's testimony. And I remember hearing Dr. Hiles say that he was with John Rice one time when Dr. Rice was 70 years old. And a pretty teenage girl came up and gave Dr. Rice a hug and kissed him on the cheek. And Dr. Hiles said, "Dr. Rice, I can't wait till I'm 70 years old and the pretty girls will come up and give me a kiss on the cheek." And Dr. Rice said, "Dr. Hiles, it takes more than just being 70 years old." So it must. I haven't achieved that, but I thank you. Love the church. Love what's going on. I'm going to preach something different than I'd intended. I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 2 as Brother Chapel was beginning that great sermon, wonderful message. My attention was directed to a different portion of Scripture than I'd intended to preach on. And let me say a word about the things at my table. A couple of the books are gone. They're sold out. If there's still several left of the other books. If you want anything that I'm out of, if you'll pay the regular price that I offered you last night, I will mail it to you and pay the postage. So you'll have the same opportunity, just take a little bit longer before it gets here. The books are all back in stock, and we should not have any problem with that. And so I want to take care of you. I don't know how much is there now. I haven't been there since lunch to see how much was stolen since I was there last time, but I'm sure it'll be fine. Stand with me if you don't mind. Matthew chapter 2 and verse 1. "Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he that is born king of the Jews?'" That's interesting, isn't it? It's hard to be born a king. The son of a king is not a king. The son of a king is a prince. But Jesus is not the son of a king. He's the son of God. He is the King of kings. "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. I guess so. He thought he was the king of the Jews. It'd be like if somebody came in tomorrow and said to Brother Armstrong, "Where's the pastor of Tucson Baptist?" We said, "I'm the pastor." I know, I mean the new pastor. He was troubled. "And when he gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophets, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.' Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search diligently for the young child, and when you've found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also.' When they'd heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they'd opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful meeting. Thank you for the privilege of being here with my dear friend, Brother Chapel. Thank you for the great model and example ministry that you have raised up in Lancaster and the wonderful help that it is to all of us. Thank you for Brother Armstrong and his people working so hard to be a blessing to pastors from all around this state and neighboring states. Thank you for my preacher brethren who've come. Lord, encourage us and strengthen us and correct us. Empower me by your Spirit to say just what you once said. Bind Satan and his demons. May they fail as they seek to snatch this good seed of your perfect word away from our heart. But may we be prepared soil to receive what you have for us. Bless the preaching. Bless the invitation. We'll thank you in Jesus' name for what you do. Amen. May be seated. Before we begin tonight, I want to mention a preacher that is with us this evening that you didn't get to meet because he was able to be here just in the evening services. Pastor Cody Cool is back in the center section, and his story bears telling. 6 months after he got saved, he was a student at West Coast Baptist College. All he knows about the ministry, he learned from West Coast Baptist College. Well, his whole beginning of that. There was a young lady he met there. One day, Danielle Chapel, now Danielle Mord, the preacher's oldest daughter, was out visiting for their open house, invited a young lady to come. She not only came, but when she got there, Danielle led her to Christ. Her name was Shonda. And Brother Cool met Shonda in college, and they were serving in Las Vegas, and in the strangest kind of a circumstance, got a call to candidate at a church in Michigan. I think you said there were 17 to 20 adults when he went there, the Breton Road Baptist Church. It was on land that had been poisoned by a landfill. They found that out later on. I don't know if anything's wrong, but every time I went there, I turned green when I drank from the drinking fountain. And now, what'd you have recent Sunday, Brother Cool? How much? 250. Bought 12 acres of property and found it was going to cost a lot of money to build on that. God opened a building. They bought another building and got that all fixed up. They'll still sell that other building probably and build on the property someday. And just doing it right. I've gotten to preach for many times, and solid, solid Christians being built at that church. And it's a testimony to the power of God, the faithfulness of a servant of God, and the kind of training you can get at the West Coast Baptist College. And I appreciate Brother Cool and glad that he's here. Well, I'm going to start with a quiz tonight. Don't worry if you don't do too well because you didn't have any warning and might not have had time to study. But everybody has to answer, okay? Three questions, they're all true or false. And you can answer true or false or If you're a teenager, that would be your preferred answer, I know. So question number one, true or false, three wise men came to visit the Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody says true, raise your hand. Everybody says false, raise your hand. Everybody says say. The uhs have it so far. Question number two, the wise men came to visit the baby Jesus in the manger. Everybody says false, raise your hand. Everybody says true, raise your hand. Everybody says, I would rather not raise my hand. Raise your hand. Question number three. The wise men were guided by a star from their home to the place where Jesus was. Everybody says true, raise your hand. Everybody says false, raise your hand. Everybody says I'm getting nervous. Raise your hand. Well, how about if we look to the Bible, find out the answer. Is that okay? Pretty good place to go. So the Bible says, in the days of Herod the king, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. How many does it say there were? It doesn't say. Now, we've assumed there were three because they gave three kinds of gifts, the gold, the frankincense, and the myrrh. But it really doesn't say. The likelihood is there was quite a large number. You wouldn't make such a long journey, taking some months over dangerous roads, infested by robbers in various places. We've had a pretty good group, and some of them armed. But the answer is, just says wise men. Question number two, the wise men came to visit the baby Jesus in the manger, and the answer is? False. They came to the house where the young child was. Oh, no, you say, Brother Willette, I've got a nativity set at my house. I just got the bin out of the garage to get ready to decorate for Christmas. I bought it at Walmart. It was made in China. And there's the baby Jesus and the wise men and the shepherds and all the animals all together. I know, but it says they came to the house where the young child was. Question number three. Wise men were guided from their home to the place where Jesus was by a star. Oh, you say, I know that because we sing, we three kings of Orient are. Bearing gifts, we traverse a far field and fountain, hill and mountain, following yonder star. I know, but can I give you a little thought? It'd be better to get your theology from the Bible than from songs. In fact, it'd be a good idea if songwriters got their theology from the Bible before they wrote the songs. Now, I'm not real picky about it. I used to have a guy graduate of the same place your preacher and I did, and he was real picky about the songs have to be right and the words have to mean what they say, have to be all correct, and he didn't like newer songs. So one time he was singing the song, Footsteps of Jesus That Make the Pathway Glow. I said, what does that mean? Does the Bible ever say the pathway where the Lord Jesus walked glowed? Did he have radioactive sandals? I mean, what's... Now, we sing a lot of songs that aren't right. For example, we sing, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more. Well, when does the trumpet of the Lord sound? It sounds at the rapture. When will time be no more? At the end of the millennium, at least 1,007 years later, and that songwriter just stuck them all together. Let's look and see what it says. It says, when Jesus was born in Herod in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men. That's verse 1. What are the next three words in Matthew chapter 2, verse 1? There came wise men what? From the east. What's it say, wise men? What are the next three words? From the east. Where were they from? The east. I'm sorry, Westerners. They weren't from the Midwest. I don't know why they call Michigan Midwest. It's as far north as you can go. They call it Midwest. And it's not anywhere near the middle either, but or the west. But it's not the Midwest. It's not the west. They're from the east. Saying, verse 2, where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we, what are the next two words? Have seen. Is that present tense? What tense is it? Past tense. Yeah. Have seen his star. Where'd they see it? We have seen his star where? In the east. Where were they from? Where does the Bible say they saw the star? In the east. You doing okay? And are come to worship him. Let's go to verse 9. The Bible says, when they heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they, what's the next word? Saw. What tense is that? Past tense. Saw where? What are the next three words? In the east. Where were they from? Where does it say they saw the star? In the east. We doing okay? And we don't have to look at the Greek or anything here. The star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they said, there it is. We've been following it every day. Right? They rejoiced with exceeding great joy. Not like it's been something they've been doing every day, but something like, wow, there it is again. If I have not yet convinced you, let me give you one more proof from our passage. Where was the Lord Jesus born? Bethlehem, very good. Where did the wise men go? Jerusalem. It's at least 8 miles from Bethlehem to Jerusalem, depending what part of what and how you figure it was in those days and where the borders were, but about 8 miles. If that star was guiding them, it did a lousy job. Would you pay $1,800 extra when you buy your next car to get a navigational system guaranteed to get you within 8 miles of your desired destination? So, here's what it says happened. At the beginning of their journey, they saw a star. They knew that it heralded the coming of the King of the Jews. The wise men were the Medes of the Medo-Persian Empire. They weren't kings, they were king makers. They were the powers behind the throne. And there was a widespread understanding, and this time, that there was to come a marvelous, miraculous, magnificent birth. Now, I can't prove what I'm about to suggest to you, but I'm going to tell you why I think those wise men knew that. There was another wise man a long time before them named Daniel. Daniel knew all about the coming of the Lord Jesus, the prince that should come to have stone cut out without hands. And I think Daniel said to his fellow wise men, listen, whenever this comes, it's going to be the biggest thing in the history of the world. Drop everything and go see it. You don't want to miss this. Now, whether that's true or not, they saw the star. They said, that's it. And they made a long journey. At the beginning of the journey, they were guided by a star. The star was clear. It was compelling. It was convincing. But somewhere pretty early in the journey, early enough that they would still be said to be in the east, because they saw the star in the east. Pretty early in the journey, the star stopped shining. What you do when the star stops shining is really important. Wise men could have said, well, we'll just wait here until we see the star again. No star, no progress. They could have said, well, we go back home. Maybe it was a mistake. Maybe we just misunderstood it. It was just some kind of comet. You know what they did? They did the best they knew. They were looking for the King of the Jews, so they went to Jerusalem. That's the capital of Israel. That's where you'd imagine the King of the Jews would be. If I said to you, go find Barack Obama, the first place you'd likely look would be 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, Washington, D.C. He might not be there. He might be making courageous speeches against, oh, not Islamic terrorism. What is it he's against? Random acts of violence. He might be at Camp David. He might be playing golf somewhere. But the most likely place that you'd find him is 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. So they went to Jerusalem. And when they got there, they said, where is he? Somebody said if the three wise men had been three wise women, they would have asked for directions. Arrived early, cleaned out the manger, and had a casserole waiting for Mary and Joseph when they got there. Somebody else said the reason it took Moses 40 years to cross the wilderness was that even back then, men would not stop and ask for directions. You know, you think... Folks in our churches, you think we have a hotline to heaven. Well, we do, but it isn't any different than the one you have. And we just always have a sense of direction, a vision, know what God wants us to do. The honest truth, a whole lot of times, if you said, preacher, what are we going to do about this? And we told you what we're thinking, we'd say, Yeah. You see, this example we see with the wise men is a pattern that's repeated throughout Scripture. Clear, compelling, convincing direction at the beginning, but pretty early in the journey, the star stops shining. What you do when the stars stop shining is really important. Abraham, go to a land that I'll show you. I'll make of you a great nation. I'll make your name great. Abraham packed up, went around the Fertile Crescent, came to the land of promise. When he got there, he had one major problem. To be there when it happens. He ran away. He had a few followers. Everybody argues about when the church started. It started at Pentecost. It started in the ministry of Jesus. No, it started in the Old Testament. Because the Bible says we went out with David, everyone that was in debt, and everyone that was discontented, and everyone that was distressed. If that's not an independent, fundamental Baptist church, you tell me what it is. And David's running away, and Saul's chasing him. And one day, David says, I shall now perish one day by the hand of Saul. There's nothing better for me but that I should speedily escape into the land of the Philistines. And Saul's in despair to find me in any coast of Israel. And he ran and joined forces with a Philistine king. Achish, the king of Gath. I'm just saying, there was a long period in David's life, the star was not shining. Hey, you guys don't believe this dream I had. It is so cool. There's these sheaves, and there was one for each of our brethren, the sons of our family, and your sheaves all bowed down to mine. Isn't that cool? David made a fatal mistake. A lot of young Baptist preachers make. He told his brothers his dreams. And they did not share his enthusiasm. And one day they took him and took that coat of many colors his father had given him. Demonstration of his father's favoritism towards him. And they smeared it with the blood of an animal, and they took Joseph and sold him to be a slave. And Joseph ended up in Egypt in the house of a man named Potiphar. And Joseph was an amazing guy. Joseph, wherever you find him, he's always the same. He always honors God. He always works hard. He always rises to the top. And the Bible says that eventually Potiphar put more and more into Joseph's care. The Bible says Potiphar didn't know what he had in the house save the meat that he did eat, the bread that he did eat. Somebody else noticed Joseph. Mrs. Potiphar noticed him. See, the Bible says Joseph was a goodly person and well-favored. That's not two ways of saying the same thing. Goodly means he had a handsome countenance, and well-favored means he had a good physique. So he was a lot like... He's a lot like Brother Howard and I think we used to be. And she said, hey, big boy, you and me ought to get together. And he said, no, ma'am. No, he said, your husband's trusted me. He hadn't kept anything back from him but you because you're his wife. And besides, it's just flat wrong. How then could I do this great wickedness and sin against God? She kept after him. One day found him in the house alone, grabbed his coat. He ran away, leaving the coat. She used that to try to say that he had been the aggressor to her. And he wound up in jail. But in jail, he works hard, and he rises to the top. And whatever's done in the prison, Joseph was the doer of it. And one day he comes along, two of these fellow prisoners who are now under his care, and he sees that they're sad. Anybody ever done jail work? Quite common for the guards to really be worried about the emotional condition of their prisoners, isn't it? Oh, you look sad today. Is everything all right? Well, they say we've dreamed some dreams. Nobody can tell us what they mean. If it had been me, I probably would have said, oh, I do some dream interpreting. Maybe I can help you. Joseph always gave the glory to God. He said, do not interpretations belong to God. He said to the butler, in 3 days you'll be back serving Pharaoh. When you do, remember me. Only time he asked for anything for himself in the whole story. Think on me. The Bible says, yet did not the chief butler remember Joseph, but forgot him. Long time in the life of Joseph, the star was not shining. Young man decides God wants him to be a missionary, and he comes, and he never says this. He never says, well, I got to do something with my life, and I don't really like factory work, and so I've always wanted to travel, so I think I'll be a missionary, and we're going to go to Spain. If it doesn't work out, we'll go somewhere else, and we hope you'll give us some money. He doesn't say that. He says, God has called us to the land of Spain. The stars shining. It's clear. He knows God wants him to go. He can tell you the time and the place that the Lord began to work in his heart and when he made the decision to surrender. And he gets his support and he goes to Spain. And everything's different. The food's different. The language is different. The dress is different. The customs are different. The smells are different. And people don't respond terribly well to him in his early days. And pretty early in the ministry, he begins to wonder, is this going to work? Am I going to succeed at this or not? Maybe I made a mistake. Early on, the star stops shining. Young man says, God has called me to plant a church in such and such a place. He never says, well, we'll give it a shot, see how it works out. No, the star's shining. It's clear. He knows he's supposed to go, and he goes. And most of the time, the biggest attendance they have in the first 6 months is on the first Sunday. And there's, wow. The crowd goes so low he doesn't want to say dearly beloved because some widow lady might blush. He says, I don't know if it's going to work or not. I thought we'd have more people by now. We're no way going to be self-supporting within a year, like I told all those churches I went out to see on deputation. It may be. We're going to do something else, and the stars stop shining. It happens in the life of a Christian in a church like this. They get convicted that the tithe is the Lord's, and they promise God to begin to tithe, and they write out the first check, and they're scared, but they're excited. They can hardly wait to get home, open the mailbox, and see that they have won $5,000 a week for life. I don't know if this is true, but I just bet you, if you check it, the average age of those publishers, clearinghouse, sweepstakes winners is probably about 94. And there's no checks, just bills. And after a few weeks, they think, I thought God was going to bless me. I thought I'd have a raise by now. I thought I'd get some overtime. I thought I'd find some unexpected money in a mailbox. I don't think this is going to work. It's always that way. Early in the marriage, the star stops shining. One of the sweetest couples in our church, Lee and Carolee Edwards, they're both in their upper 70s. He's the great-great-grandson of Devil Ants Hatfield. Dad was a drunk and a gambler, but functioned and worked. One day, a man at work invited him to the Central Baptist Church in Cincinnati, Ohio, and for the first time ever, the entire Edwards family went to church, and they all got saved. His dad went on to be a Bible college student and then a preacher and then a professor in that Bible college, earning a PhD. I have a yearbook from the 1970s they dedicated to Clarence Edwards, and they said there are 40 independent Baptist churches in the Cincinnati area, and 25 of their pastors were trained by Brother Clarence Edwards. And Lee and Carolee got married. He came home one day after work, and he was sitting down on the bed. And she said, we don't sit on the bed when it's made. He said, what? That was just their value system where she came from. We don't sit on the bed once it's made. He said, this is my house, and this is my bed, and if I want to sit on it, I will. A very nice man, but he was going to draw the line about bed sitting. And she said, well, the honeymoon's over. Yeah, your problems may not have been that severe. But early on, you have a child. Oh, you're so excited. You read all the books and you write down all the things and you're going to do all this and that and you got it all figured out and it works pretty good till they go to school. And you get through that and then they become a teenager. An alien sucked the life out of your child and inhabit that body. Who are you and where did you put my son? Whoa. Mark Twain said when a child became a teenager, you ought to put him in a box and just leave a hole there to give him food and water. He said when they turn 17, you should plug up the hole. I'm just saying. star shines real clearly at first, and pretty early in the journey it stops. But when Abraham was 100 and Sarah was 90, God gave him a son. Just like he said. And the day came when Saul died in battle, not by the hand of David. And David was anointed to be the king over the nation of Israel. And there was that time after about 22 years that Joseph's brothers come down because there's corn in Egypt. And Joseph has interpreted Pharaoh's dream and has become essentially the prime minister of the nation of Egypt. And his brothers, not recognizing, come and giving homage to this foreign leader. They bow down before him. And then Joseph remembered his dream. I'm going to say three things and I'll be done. Number one, the star does not always shine. It's okay. It's normal. Don't be discouraged. Don't be disappointed. Don't think that something's gone wrong, that you're not sure what to do. Everything's foggy. A lot of our lives we spend kind of like somebody driving through the fog. Number two, God expects us to be faithful when the star doesn't shine. So I don't know what to do. Well, keep on heading toward Jerusalem. Do the best you know. I heard about an old man sitting by the side of the road, and the traveler came by, and he said, "Mister, is this the way to such and such a town?" And the old man answered him kind of strangely. He said, "Well, where are you from?" He told him, he said, "Well, you've come too far to go back. The side road is worse. This is no place to spend the night. Looks to me like you might as well just go on. I don't know about you, but I've come too far to go back. I've seen what happens to people who get off track, and the side road is worse, and this is no place to spend the night. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through it. Looks to me like we just might as well go on." Amen. What you do when the stars stop shining is really important. Third thing is this. Herod the king heard these things. He was troubled. He gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, verse 4 of Matthew 2, and he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet." Now, once they started out toward Bethlehem, the star reappeared, and it took him exactly to the house where Jesus was. But they didn't start out toward Bethlehem because of the star. They started out towards Bethlehem because thus it is written by the prophet. The star doesn't always shine. God expects us to be faithful when the star does not shine. And I may not always have a star, but I always have the Word of God. That Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We misunderstand that verse. We translate it in our mind in a 21st century technology. And we think one of these $5 million flashlights that you plug in and charge up, it'll shine from here to Phoenix for about 5 minutes. There was no such thing in Bible times. All that they had was an oil lamp, and they would wear it on the ankle of a traveler because the light was so dim. If you held it up here, you couldn't see the pathway. But if you had it on your ankle, you could see enough just to tell you where to put your foot for the next step. God doesn't promise to let you know what's going to happen in 10 years or 5 years or 6 months, but He does promise to give you guidance for the next step. You know what? I know I'm supposed to be in church Sunday because it tells me in the Word of God not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. I know I'm supposed to read this book because it says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart." I know that I'm supposed to love my wife because the Bible tells me, "Husbands, love your wives." I know that wives should submit to their husbands because the Bible says so. I know you're supposed to tithe because it tells me that in the Word of God. I know you should live separate from the world because the Bible instructs me to do that. I know that parents should raise their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and children should honor and obey their parents because I find it in the Bible. I know I should give the gospel to every creature because the Bible tells me to. I may not always have a star, but praise God, I've always got a book. Amen. Danny Wyola was 11. When the automobile accident that took his left arm occurred, he was in a funk, depressed. And for some reason, his parents hit on the idea of enrolling him in judo lessons. And it actually worked. He liked being with the other guys. He liked having that gi on. Normally when you take judo, the teacher has some basic throws you learn first. You learn the ogoshi and the okigoshi and the osotogari. If you do well at those, you can learn the Kawasaki, the Suzuki, and the Yamaha. Danny's sensei, his teacher, didn't teach him any of those throws. He just taught him one throw. None of the other kids at his stage in the class learned that throw. And he did the same throw over and over and over and over and over again. But he liked it. He liked the activity. He liked feeling he could do something. And one day the teacher said, Danny, you're ready to enter a tournament. I want you to come with me next Saturday. He said, wow. So the sensei picked him up. They drove to the tournament. Danny won the first match readily. Second match was harder, but he won that too. Third match was really tough, but he hung in there and he won that match. And now he found himself in the finals. His opponent is older, stronger, more experienced. And Danny's getting thrown around a good little bit. But he's game. He keeps getting back up and trying to go in. And the referee sees how badly he's being thrown. And he says to the sensei, would you like us to just call the match? And he said, no, Danny will be fine. Just leave him there. Danny finally sees his opportunity. He reaches in and he executes the only throw he knows. He not only flips his opponent to the mat, but he pins him there and wins the match. Crowd goes wild. Danny gets his trophy. They're driving home. It's quiet in the car. And after a little while, Danny said, teacher, why did I win? I only know one throw and I only have one arm. The teacher said, well, Danny, there are two reasons that you won. The first one is that you have mastered, or nearly mastered, one of the most difficult throws in judo. The second is that the only known defense against it is to grab your opponent by his left arm. Danny didn't know that. He just knew the teacher said, do that throw, do that throw, do that throw, do that throw. He traveled without the star. He was faithful when the star didn't shine. You know what's going to happen? You're going to get to heaven and you say, I didn't know that. I didn't know that was the reason for that. I didn't know God was doing that. I didn't know God brought all that good out of that difficult time in my life. But that won't happen unless you just keep doing the thing you've already been told to do, whether it makes sense or not. The star does not always shine. God expects us to be faithful when the star doesn't shine. We don't always have a star, but we always have the Word of God. Our Heavenly Father, I could not know the burden and the need of every person here, and if I did, I couldn't speak to it, but you can, and I trust that you've brought this message into my mind because you wanted to use it to help some of your people. I trust to be many of your people. I pray you'd give me your mind as I extend the invitation. Heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Really, the sermons go together. Don't worry about being great. Worry about serving the Lord Jesus. Don't worry if it makes sense to you or not. Just do what he said. You'll understand it better by and by. Heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, nobody's looking around. I wonder who says, I'm God's child and heaven is my home, but I need to apply the truth that I've heard, the truths in this message, these messages tonight. God's dealt with me. Pray with me. If you say that, hold your hand up high. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Would you do something a little different? Why don't you just, if you raise your hand, or maybe didn't but should have, why don't you just get out of your seat and come right now, find a place at the altar to do business with God. We'll stand and we'll have music and all that. It's good, but I think it's good to cultivate the habit of immediate obedience to the Spirit of God. Father, bless these who are coming. Help others who ought to come to do so as well. Thank you for your word and its great help to our lives. We praise you for what you're doing, what we trust you to continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand if you would, please, if you're still in the seat. The music will play. If God's Spirit spoke in your heart, and you need to do business with him, you come on as well.
Let's sing that first verse there together.
In the light.